notice how many fences they're getting to be?
The signs they get on them. No hunting, no hiking, no admission, no trespass. Private property, closed area. Start moving, get lost, drop dead, go away.
Master of the silver screen, Kirk Douglas there. The legendary screenplay, Lonely Are the Brave, written by Edward Abbey and Dalton Trumbo. The theme of the film is a free-range riding cowboy come into the city to break his best friend out of the county jail. He lands himself in the slammer after a fight with a one-armed Mexican, which he loses badly. The rest of the film serves up amazing scenes in the key of Cool Hand Luke. The terminus will leave you with a rock in your gut. As we descend into the subway here, you know, I don't ride the subway as much as I once did, mostly because I moved to Hollywood a long time ago, but about 7 or so years ago, I got attacked by a wiry junkie with jailhouse tattoos and a dirty face. I'd gotten off in Compton because I realized I'd forgotten to tap my card. By the time I made it to the terminal, my train was gone. It was about 15 minutes to the next train. Now, at the time, I was on my way to the Mayan for a private show for the band Imagine Dragons. So I'm on my way. I've got my backpack with 2 camera bodies and several lenses, a laptop, batteries. And my backpack weighs easily like 50 pounds. So I'm waiting for the train, and sometimes I like to just walk up and down the terminal, just to keep the blood flowing. And I pass by one of those large pillars at the terminal, and out of the corner of my eye, I see the fully wound junkie fist headed toward my face. It's a slow motion blur of knuckle tattoos and skin stained by soot on the street. Pow. Right in the kisser. And he connected. I mean, he landed every bit of wiry, junky kinetic energy that only a diet of methamphetamine, light beer, and bargain brand cigarettes could produce. Felt as though a fly had landed on my cheek. As he watched me laugh, his eyes sank and all the blood drained out of his face. I think he figured I was from Brentwood or something. But as you'll see later, I'm not too big or anything, but I'm bigger than Mr. T, Vin Diesel, etc. This guy was small. There was a deep look of loss in his eyes as I stood in front of him, unfazed. "Let's go," he said, as he pumped his fists up and down like Mike Tyson punch-out character. I hate to tell you this, but that's not the first time I've been punched in the face. And I'm not going to fight you, I'm going to work. His countenance dropped further. It seemed pretty obvious to me that what he really wanted was for me to put down my bag so he could use his superior junkie speed to spirit away my cameras. The funny part was that if he had tried to pick up my bag, I mean, it would have been like running, trying to carry 50 bricks. There was a janitorial worker from Metro on the terminal, maybe like 30 feet behind me. I yelled out for him to call the cops, and the guy just bolted like a gnat. And I'm not a good fighter. I've been punched in the face more than once in my life, but I've only been in a couple real fights. You know, back when this happened, they had the LA County Sheriffs on Metro Patrol. A few deputies arrived just 90 seconds after the kid left. When I tried to describe what the kid looked like, I asked the deputies, "Have you ever seen that show Ripper Street?" "No," they said. So I pulled out a picture and was like, "Imagine a meth-headed version of Bennett Drick." Told them all about it, declined to file a report, went on my way as I was already running close to call time. You know, another time, at this very station that I was at on Vine, left from, I was sitting alone on the terminal side of a northbound train. As we were pulling into the station, the train slowed, and, you know, the images at the window just kind of slowly come to a stop. And right outside my window, I saw the biggest man I have ever seen, easily 6'8", lumbering toward a small Asian woman in her 20s. Her face was swollen with the red mark of a large handprint. He had obviously just struck her in the face before we arrived. The woman was so scared she couldn't even move backward. She just flexed at the knees and cowered, shaking as he edged closer, just feet away. Another man, smaller like the woman, moved to block the larger man's progress. He looked like that picture of the Chinese guy standing in front of that tank. Closer. I mean, he was just getting closer and closer. He wasn't stopping. The small man disappeared into the large man's chest as he flexed his feet to try and stop him. All of this happens in less than a second. As I reached for my hat on the empty seat next to me, I felt a cold chill run down my entire spine, all the way down my toes into my boots. I'll be completely honest, I was more yellow than an Oscar Mayer wiener on a hot summer day in mustard country. I swear to God. I swallowed hard, picked up my hat, and rose out of the chair. I was the only one big enough to stop him, at least for a little while. Moving robotically toward the door, I forced myself not to think about it. A ding of two bells and the doors began to open. I was already sweating. Then I heard someone shout, "Sheriff's Department, get down on the ground right now." The giant of a man hit the floor so fast it looked like he was doing the worm. He went face first, gracefully, like he was diving into a pool. I looked over to see a 5'4" female officer with what looked to be a Beretta 9mm. At 15 feet away, she might as well have had a slingshot. She stood her ground. The subway driver came over the intercom, declared an emergency. The doors locked closed. Two more deputies came racing down the stairs. One held a taser to the man's side while the other cuffed him, and the first officer kept her gun trained. In a moment, it was over. The man got up peacefully and walked away. I never saw what happened to the woman. The train sped away to the next stop without ever completely opening the doors. I was so grateful for that woman and the sheriff's department that day. Since then, the city has spent $645 million to beef up patrols on the metro, doubling the amount of officers that cover the city buses and subways. There used to be a saying, if you want to avoid crime on the subway, stay off the red line. That's the downtown LA, Hollywood, North Hollywood route. I don't ride as much as I used to, but it's been years since I've seen anything that even looked like trouble. I noticed when LAPD first took over, they focused on checking tickets and cleaning all of the turnstile jumpers that seemed to have a big effect.
Yeah, boy.
If I get murdered in the city, don't go revenging in my name. One person dead from such is plenty, no need to go get locked away. When I leave your arms, the things that I think of No need to get over alarmed. I'm coming home. Wonder which brother is better, which one our parents loved most. I sure did get in lots of trouble, they seemed to let the other go. A tear fell from my father's eyes. I wondered what my dad would say. He said, I love you and I'm proud of you both. In so many different ways. If I get murdered in the city, go read the letter in my desk. Don't bother with all my belongings, but pay attention to the list. Make sure my sister knows I loved her. Make sure my mother knows the same. Always remember there was nothing worth sharing like the love that let us share our name. Always remember there was nothing worth sharing like the love that let us share our name.
Running after them because
5,000 miles of storm drain channels, the distance from LA to New York and back again, under your soles. Shoveled in the 1920s and 30s by workers paid a dollar a day. ...42,803 miles of power and communication cables under Hill Street Avenida. Enough cable to circle Mars 10 times. ...38,753 streets under your souls.
Yeah. should all burn together. Watch the flames climb high into the night, calling out Father, oh, stand by and we will watch the flames burn over and on the mountainside. High. And if we should die tonight, we should all die together. Raise a glass of wine for the last time. Holding out Father, oh, prepare as we will watch the flames burn over and on the mountainside. Desolation comes upon the sky. Now I see fire inside the mountain. I see fire burning the trees. I see fire.
I saw the best minds of my generation destroyed by madness, starving, hysterical, naked, dragging themselves through the Negro streets at dawn, looking for an angry fix. Angel-headed hipsters, burning for the ancient, heavenly connection to the starry dynamo and the machinery of night. Who poverty and tatters and hollow-eyed and high set up smoking in the supernatural darkness of cold water flats floating across the tops of cities contemplating jazz. Who bared their brains to heaven under the L and saw Mohammedan angels staggering upon tenement roofs illuminated. Who passed through universities with radiant cool eyes, hallucinating Arkansas and Blake Light tragedy among the scholars of war, who were expelled from the academies for crazy and publishing obscene odes on the windows of the skull, who cowered in unshaven rooms and underwear, burning their money in waste baskets and listening to the terror through the wall, who got busted in their pubic beards, returning through Laredo with a belt of marijuana for New York, who ate fire and paint hotels or drank turpentine in Paradise Alley, death or purgatory their torsos night after night.
But still I fall in love too easily. I fall in love too fast.
Well, your mama is
Hold
so...
Hold it, wait a minute. Don't bring anyone mother into this. She ain't here. If it wasn't for your mother, you wouldn't be here. So remember, when you put down one mother, you put down mothers all over the world.
Telling everybody, if you got God in your heart, you know, the cancer don't have a chance.
Yeah.
So thanks be to God. I'm glad to be here.
Amen.
Keep the awareness going. Keep encouraging one another. And God bless everybody. Thank you. Thank you.
So that was Mr. T and Amanda Salas, the Fox News reporter. Amanda was a Fox News anchor until she got cancer. She was a beautiful woman, lost all her hair, had to go through chemo. But the good news is that I saw her last week, bumped into her at a show, and she said she's feeling much better, her hair's growing back in, she looks great. You can see Mr. T here. He's looking pretty good, too. He's a great guy. Being around Mr. T is just like getting a beta shot full of happiness.
Tacos rule.